you very much. Good morning and good evening to all the participants. Let me wish everybody today's disability World Disability Day also on this occasion. In the beginning, I also want to congratulate ILS for organizing this world conference on a very, very important theme. We have been discussing about the rights of disability, rights of persons suffering from disability for last many, many years. But the focus which is given now, as far as this conference is concerned, such persons, how and where they fit in the legal system, which is really very important. And as we heard Mr. Jain about it, and Mr. Rahul Bajaj also threw some light on the conceptualization of this particular topic. Let me begin from the beginning in order to come to this the theme of the topic, which would be necessary. I'll take a few minutes in highlighting that aspect. It's a tedious and well-fought journey for the person suffering from disability. The fight which has today we know it, and we are all talking about the issue as human rights issue. But then the traditional approaches were totally different. Initially, patronizing and paternalistic approach to medical need approach, and how we have arrived at this human rights approach. Initially, it was depicted as a health and welfare issue to be addressed through care provided to persons with disability from charitable point of view. The disabled persons are viewed as abnormal, deserving of pity and care, and not as individuals who are entitled to enjoy the same opportunities to live a full life and satisfying life as other members of the society. So in this process, disability became or was couched within a medical and welfare framework, identifying people disabilities as ill, different from their non-disabled peers, and in need of care. Because the emphasis is on medical needs of the people with disability, there was a corresponding neglect of their wider social needs, which resulted in severe isolation for people with disabilities and their families. And another cascading effect was that this resulted in marginalizing the disabled persons and their exclusion both from the mainstream of the society and enjoyment of their fundamental rights and freedom. So thankfully, it was realized over a period of time that the persons suffering from various kinds of disabilities are also in the same league and are same as their other counterparts. And it started with the, if I may say so, UN Declaration of Human Rights. The charter, although it doesn't talk specifically about disabled persons, but there was much ammunition and much substance therein, which could link it with the human development, because it acknowledged that human rights are individual and have a definite linkage of human development, both sharing common vision and with a common purpose. Respect for human rights is the root for human development and realization of full potential of each individual, which in turn leads to the augmentation of human resources with progress of the nation. So this linkage with the human right development in that UN declaration, and emphasizing dignity in the process, and also mentioning about the equality, which is founded upon two complementary principles, that is non-discrimination and reasonable differentiation. I think it made all the difference. Of course, thereafter, there was two major declarations on the disabled, one in December 20th, 1971, which was on rights of mentally retarded persons. And thereafter, in 1975, when the General Assembly of UN adopted the Declaration on Rights of Disabled Persons, which proclaimed that disabled persons have the same civil and political rights as other human beings. The declaration states, and I quote, "Disabled persons should receive equal treatment and services, which will enable them to develop their capabilities and skills to the maximum and will hasten the process of their social integration or reintegration. Every word of this declaration, I think, is of importance. And three things which I find, and which we can trace it to our constitution also, because constitution, Indian constitution also doesn't specifically say about the rights of disabled persons. But as I said, one is linkage of human development with the human rights, which is based on dignity, if I may say so, and which has been highlighted time and again. And as was stated by Mr. Jain as well, dignity means right of choice, which is to be given to the persons. First is, if I may say that it's aimed at empowering a person or empowerment of the persons. And in this, three aspects which are to be kept in mind. Number one, respect for one's capacity as an agent to make one's own free choices. In the context of disability, we'll say that we have to respect the capacity of a person suffering from disability, that such a person has also the capacity to make his or her choices. And number two, respect the choices so made. Whatever choice is made, we should respect that choice. And number three, respect for one's need to have context and conditions in one in which one can operate as a source of free and informed choice. So the context and conditions in which choice is made, we have to respect that also. Now, fortunately, this dignity, as I said, that under the Indian Constitution, though there's no specific provision about the on disabled persons, but Article 14, read with 15 and 16, which talks of equality, then Article 21, which talks of fundamental right that nobody can be deprived of his life and liberty without process of law. And into this, the dignity is read, that life does not mean only an animal existence, but life which can be lived and which everybody has right to live with dignity. And third is, I would say that we have directive principles of state policy also, and Article 41 therein, which says right to work, to education and public assistance in certain cases. So from this have emerged, which I'll come little later, how the courts have interpreted the made this right as a fundamental right or human rights of the persons. Now, the question in this whole process that arises is that we have to see at this stage, in spite of all these rights, and of course we have that this Beijing Declaration in 1992, which led to the passing of the Law on Disability in 1995-96, and then new act in 2016 have given so many rights to the people. Now, main and difficult question which arises is how far we have succeeded in realizing the rights. I was reading today only in the Indian Express, Mr. Shashi Tharoor has written an article, A Failure to Enable. That is, law promises with disability equality of opportunity and accessibility, but our practices deny them that. Now, this is very, very important, and on which, when we come to the subject, I'll like to highlight that what he has said, and we have been also saying, it is the mindset of the people at large, which still denies them their right. And if I may say so here, although Mr. Jain had highlighted on that here people are not accepted in the mainstream, either even when the people, the people suffering from disability are not accepted in the mainstream, even when the other people sympathize with them. Most common, their lives are handicapped by social, culture and attitudinal barriers, which Rahul Bajaj also pointed out, which hamper their full participation and enjoyment of equal rights and opportunities. And I am reminded of Joseph Shapiro in his book. He wrote, the book name of the book is No Pity. And the first sentence of the book is, "No non-disabled Americans do not understand disabled ones." I only say that the correction which is to be made is that it is not only Americans, it is all over the world that the non-disabled people, they do not understand disabled ones. And what is important is to be seen is that they do not want any mercy. the people suffering from disability. They only want their right to grow in the society, equal opportunities, that don't sympathize with us, only have empathy. You just recognize our needs and just recognize our rights and give us the chance to grow in the society. And here, Judy Human has said, disability only becomes a tragedy for me when society fails to provide the things we need to lead our lives, job opportunities, or barrier-free buildings, for example. It is not a tragedy to me that I am living in a wheelchair. So the main thing which I feel is that, yes, change in the mindset which is required. And in this process, what is important is, if it's not a time and opportunity or rather an occasion to go into various cases which have been decided by the Indian courts insofar as disability laws are concerned. But as I see, and I only want to flag some of the points, as I see the judicial journey insofar as these rights are concerned, even after coming into effect, the law in the form of Disability Act of 1995, many provisions were still dormant, and the courts had to intervene to direct the government to activate those provisions, and which happened in even in after 2016 in this Rajiv Rathuri case also, where directions were given by the Supreme Court to as well as access to public places, etc., is concerned. And this many institutions were not following, like 3% reservation. Directions had to be given. That I had seen at one place, that's where the court had to, Delhi High Court had given the directions that to claim the benefits of disability, the certificates which are to be issued, the hospitals were not designated under the act which is to be done. So direction was given to do that also. Now, other aspect which I want to highlight is the pragmatic and human rights approach which is given by the court. And there are so many judgments where very bold interpretation to various provisions was given. And in many cases, the courts have interpreted in a manner or gave the direction which amount to change in the mindset of the people also. Like I remember in one case, a person suffering from, he was handicapped, was not appointed as a physical training teacher. The High Court gave the direction that he should be appointed, because when under the Act, this is not treated as disability or disqualification for that particular post, why he is not appointed. Same applied to in one visually impaired lady who was not appointed as music teacher in university. Direction was given to appoint her. And another case was of blind person who was, in spite of clearing and the not only written examination and interview also, not appointed as IAS officer, where the direction was given by the court. No, so therefore, all these directions are given. And when it comes to various other fields, like as I've said, in the administration, in the sports, etc., when it is given, why not one when we come to the legal, this legal field, why this mindset? Now, Mr. Rahul had rightly pointed out about the judgment of the courts, which have been recently given, when they said that if 40 to 50% disability visual impairment is concerned, the person should not be appointed as member of the Tamil Nadu Judicial Service. This, I would say, is a, I mean, to some extent, I'm little baffled when on the one hand, Supreme Court has been giving all these directions, positive direction for advancement of the rights of the people. Why, when it comes to visually impaired persons in the judicial service, they should not be appointed? Of course, one can see this from different angles. And maybe what was in the mind of the court was that a person in judicial service, say at magisterial level, or who is a session judge, has to come across the persons, and like when the evidence, etc., is to be recorded, he or she has to see the demeanor of the witness and may not be able to do function of a judge more effectively. But here in this panel itself, we have four judges, out of which two are visually impaired, who are there and who have been judges, and they have shown that they can be, and both of them are outstanding judges, world known judges. And if they can overcome their physical disability or even the impairment as well as visual impairment is concerned, why not? Now, I take it this from another angle also. Let us presume that a judge who is a able judge, so-called able judge, because when we say in which category we fall, and the cases come before him or her of a person where either the person, the litigant, is visually or otherwise physically impaired, or the advocate who appears is physically handicapped or visually handicapped, or a witness who appears having such a kind of handicappedness. In order to do justice in that matter, it is for that judge to ensure level playing field and to overcome and ensure the process, due process, which takes care of that disability, so that the person is able to depose, the person is able to present the case, and the person is able to argue if he is or she is an advocate. So therefore, once this becomes the duty of the judiciary or the judges to impart justice and to do justice in a particular case, notwithstanding the fact that the person appearing before him or her suffers from disability, any of these stakeholders, then why not? It should be translated that such a person can, with such disability, can sit as a judge also and take care. Rather, I would say such a person would be more sensitive towards the needs of the person suffering from a disability. So therefore, my humble submission is that notwithstanding, good thing, as far as Delhi is concerned, we know it as we have found that Mr. Jaggi is there, who is our district judge, who has been appointed because of the fact that there is a reservation, and which has been provided by the Delhi judiciary. This need to be replicated everywhere. 3% reservation for the person suffering from disability is the norm. This is the right of such people. So once that is there, it should not be in the mind of, and it's only totally a case of mindset, which has to be changed. And whether it is a visually blind, impaired person, or whether suffering from any other disability, I don't think that a person cannot do. Our science is developing at a fast pace. We have been, thus far, and today there are many scientific instruments, etc., from where the persons from such disability can overcome the disability and discharge their function. This is recognized, if I may say so, in 2000 Act as well. And that is why in Rajiv Rathuri, all that what is provided in the Act, the direction was given to the government that this is what the law gives them the benefit to do this, right to public access. And when in braille form, we can give the material, etc., whether it is in the form of case law or it is in the form of text or it is in the form of BEREX, etc., it can be provided, then why not a person can discharge the function as a judge also? So that mindset has to change. And I say at the end that I'll be, like Mr. Jain has said, that I'll be, and I can say on behalf of Justice Lokur also, that we would be the happiest persons if during our lifetime we see some such visually impaired person as the judge of the High Court or the Supreme Court. Thank you very much.